I request all PGDM students to please settle down.
Good morning and welcome back from the break. I am Sudeeksha.
I am Rahul.
We will be starting with the first session, for which we will have presentations by eminent speakers of our industry. The theme for the presentation is Insurance by 2025, Strategies for Combating the Emerging Challenges in the Upcoming Lustrum. This will be followed by a Q&A session.
It is our great pleasure to introduce you to the renowned personalities that will be forming the dais. We have with us Mr. Sandeep Ghosh, partner and leader at Ernst & Young India, Mr. Bhargav Das Gupta, MD and CEO at ICICI Lombard General Insurance Company Limited, Mr. Krishnan Ramachandran, CEO of Apollo Munich Health Insurance Company Limited, and Mr. Nilesh Garg, MD and CEO of Tata AIG General Insurance Company Limited. I request you all to please come up on stage and form the dais.
We now request our colleagues to formally welcome the dignitaries with a floral bouquet. We welcome you, sir. We will be beginning with the presentations. We have with us Mr. Sandeep Ghosh, who will be presenting on boardroom concerns heading towards 2025. But before we start, we would like to introduce sir to the audience. Sir is the partner and leader at Ernst & Young India. Mr. Ghosh is a part of senior leadership in the firm where he leads the financial services advisory practice. With an expertise in managing partnerships, alliances, and joint ventures, Sir has nearly 3 decades of experience in insurance and banking and other allied sectors. Prior to joining Ernst & Young, Sir was MD and CEO of Bharti AXA Life Insurance Company Limited. I would request Sir to begin with the presentation.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Mr. Srinivasan and the Insurance Institute for inviting me here. And good morning to my fellow distinguished speakers as well. I'll take the next 15-odd minutes to talk about the boardroom concerns that the insurance sector is looking at as you look ahead to the next 5-6 years of the evolution of the industry. If there's one thing that you've heard from the speakers in the morning as well, one particular word that I'd like to touch upon, it is this word called disruption. And fundamentally, the insurance sector is clearly undergoing significant disruption. And this is true of, you know, the global insurance sector. It's equally true of the sector in India. Essentially, the pace of innovation is really fast in this industry. In some ways, one may argue that we are playing catch up to banking and some of the other financial services sectors. But comparisons aside, there is a real fast pace of innovation that is unraveling. And fundamentally, technology is disrupting the sector and is disrupting the way of doing business in insurance. I'd like to touch upon a few forces that are at play in the industry at the moment, which is also shaping the future of the industry. Clearly, there are some significant changes in the global marketplace. And whether you talk about demographics, whether you talk about customer expectations, the rise of fintech, insurtech, and the pivot to Asia, I think Mr. Girija Kumar spoke about this in the morning, that the large economies of China, India, Indonesia are growing at a significantly faster pace in terms of insurance growth, insurance penetration, and this is being driven by the demographic dividend, by rising incomes, the industrial growth that is taking place in these economies. You also have significant geopolitical shifts happening. You know, the trade wars, the blockades, Brexit is having a significant impact in the way the Western world and developed and emerging markets are seeing trade unfold. A lot of reform on the tax code and fundamental disruption in terms of fiscal and corporate governance. The third thing, sort of the third pillar of forces at play is around digital transformation. It is a combination of technology disruption, cost pressures, which is forcing the sector to rethink business models. And the industry is exploring new partnership models across the value chain, and I'm going to touch upon that in subsequent slides. Last but not the least is the data revolution. The data technology breakthroughs that are happening, the accelerated value of data, and the insights that you derive from data to take decisioning is playing a very significant role in the insurance sector. But it is also posing questions around privacy, security, and we'll talk about that in some more detail. I think we spoke in the morning, again, Mr. Girija Kumar gave a pretty good example of Ping An. Insurance companies are moving to become players who will offer services beyond mere insurance, and this is something we'll focus on as well. Speaking of boardroom concerns, let's also try and understand some of the risk factors and the key risks that insurance companies face. The trade wars and increasing protectionism is definitely having an impact on economic growth, trade volumes, and demand for insurance. Global market volatility, the fears of recession in some of the biggest markets in the world across the US, Europe, is also leading to long-term secular low interest rates, which has a huge impact for the life insurance sector and the pensions sector as well. Aging workforces, increased lifespan, medical inflation, we heard about these themes in the morning as well. And in structural decline in some of the large economies of the world are some of the key risk factors. We heard a speaker talk about climate change. I think insurers are still grappling with understanding how to price for the risks that are emerging on account of climate change. We talk a lot about cyber, and because of limited information, limited understanding, there is still a lot of R&D out there that is happening to understand how to model cyber risk. In some ways, cyber is interesting. It presents perhaps a $100 billion opportunity for the sector, but it also presents a $1 trillion threat. Last but not the least is this whole aspect of competition from alternative products, from new age players. I think most insurance companies and most CEOs and boards agree that the real competition for insurance could come from technology players, from the likes of Google and Amazon, and this is something which is dramatically impacting the way boardrooms and leaderships are thinking about their business and business models. Now, these risks, these forces at play, are essentially throwing up certain opportunities. And in some ways, what I will refer to as opportunities are also imperatives for the sector. And I will single out sort of three absolutely critical imperatives from our point of view. One is there is an absolute need for insurance companies to revamp their business models. What do we mean by this? You know, there is a need to look beyond traditional sector-specific processes. You know, how we underwrite policies, how we settle claims, how we sell, how we service. There is a fundamental need to relook at that. I would also talk about the fact that, this whole aspect of identifying new sources of revenue, which could either be generated by the companies or by partnerships, which go beyond traditional insurance revenue. This is becoming another imperative. And above all, if there was one sort of aspect of the revamping of business models I'd like to stress on, it is redefining the customer relationship paradigm. And I'll dwell upon this a little bit more on a subsequent slide. The second key imperative or opportunity, as you may want to look at it, is the digital and technology uplift. The digital adoption to enhance access to contextual data becomes really important. The ability to drive efficiency in operations through automation is absolutely critical. Increasing digitization across the value chain, and of course, big data analytics. So all insurance companies have to look at the digital and technology uplift. The last piece is somewhat related to the risks that I spoke about, that the new age risks represent also new age opportunities, and companies have to put their minds around how to assess these risks, how to price these risks. I will talk about some specific examples, but clearly, as I mentioned earlier, climate change is creating new risks to insure. Autonomous cars creates a whole new category of risk to insure. So the traditional motor insurance risk comes down, the risk of accidents comes down, but it's replaced by another form of risk, which is because the cars are then completely electronically wired, and that automation, that level of technology sitting in a car creates a whole new category of risk. Cyber, as I spoke about, is a huge opportunity, but it also presents some significant threats. And then, with the phenomenon of Internet of Things, you have hyper-connected future, which also throws up new monetization opportunities. So from a boardroom perspective, from a CEO's perspective, there is an absolute need to revamp the business models. There's an absolute need to focus on digital and technology uplift. And there is an absolute need to understand the new age risks, which present also new opportunities. Now, everyone gets this. The issue is not about understanding what is going on out there. The issue is that as insurance companies respond to all of this, the forces at play, the new risks, the importance of revamping business models, are they able to move quickly enough? This is one of the fundamental challenges for boardrooms, for CEOs and leaderships of insurance companies. Is that pace of change that one is able to drive through a legacy organization quick enough? So there are some specific things which are happening out there. We see a lot of focus on retail. We see a lot of focus on SME market segments. We see this whole phenomenon of integrated offerings. So because of secular long-term interest rates, insurance companies moving into more unit-linked products globally. I know that phenomenon is not so common in India because we still have, relatively speaking, higher interest rates, which will come down someday, but not the case at the moment, really. So the integration of offerings from insurance and asset management, this is a phenomenon. Bundled products is a clear phenomenon, and I'll talk about that a bit later. What we are also saying is, while there is the emergence of digital channels, what is happening in phase one is much more the digitization of the traditional or physical channels. So digitization of agency, digitization of bank assurance, digitization of broking channels is really the sort of phase one, because these channels still contribute in most markets 85-90% upwards of the total volume. So pure digital channels, end-to-end digital channels, are still small, growing at a very rapid pace. And so it's the digitization of the physical channels which is one of the key areas where insurance companies are responding. And then, of course, there is the insurtech investments. In fact, you know, I personally believe, you know, looking ahead 2025, this whole distinction between insurance players and insurtechs is going to completely blur, because the insurance companies that will survive and thrive in, you know, 5-7 years from now will fundamentally be wired so differently that you will not be able to tell the difference between what is a traditional or legacy insurance player and really an insurtech company. So that's clearly those companies that will respond and move quickly enough will start looking very different from what they look like today. Fundamentally, what this means is that boardrooms, CEOs, leaderships have to think about significant investment in what I would call technology-enabled transformation. And this is, again, around sort of 3 or 4 key pillars. There is the customer pillar. There is the digital pillar or the technology pillar, which is no longer about just you know, the front-end assets. It's actually end-to-end, front-to-back, complete technology transformation. And then there is the whole pillar around, you know, robotics, artificial intelligence, data and analytics. So this kind of transformation requires significant investment, but it also requires significant managerial courage. Anyone who takes a 1, 2, 3 year view to a business will hesitate to fundamentally embark on a major transformation journey. It is almost akin to an open heart surgery. If you talk to any insurance leader, the decision to either replace or fundamentally change the core technology backbone of the company is a very, very big decision in terms of, you know, the project risk, in terms of the investment. But, you know, medium to long term, there is no way forward but to actually embark on this. It's not a question of if, it's a question of when. And we see this phenomenon that core policy administration systems just becoming systems of record, and all the sort of front-end assets, the middleware, has to be fundamentally wired very, very differently to serve customers and meet customer expectations in the future. And this is something that is taking up significant bandwidth in organizations. So again, from an innovation priority matrix, the areas where companies are investing, companies are focusing of late, it's a lot to do with robotics and process automation. It's a lot to do with Internet of Things, which is you know, really connected devices, connected offerings, artificial intelligence, blockchain. I mean, some of this sounds like, you know, a lot of jargon, but this is reality now for the insurance sector. I mean, these are sort of the key priority areas in every forward-looking insurance company. We do believe that in 3 to 5 years from now, even at a global scale, some of the very large legacy insurers could get fundamentally disrupted. This is likely to happen. In the next 5-7 years, we do believe that somewhere around 10% of the total cars in the market could be autonomous vehicles. We already have more than 20-25 million cars across the world which have some kind of a device, and you know there is an element of telematics already in there, and you will see that not just in motor but in number of other sectors as well. And as I was talking about this whole phenomenon of autonomous vehicles, you know, as we all know, 40-45% of the non-life market in India is motor insurance. Imagine a scenario 5, 7, 10 years down the line where this segment is the one that sees the fastest or the highest levels of disruption. And as I said, you could have a significant compression of motor insurance prices because of, you know, the number of accidents going down, the number of claims going down, but a fundamental shift in the nature of risk that insurers will have to be ready to insure on account of the fact that you will have cars with very high levels of technology, which could be prone to software attacks, which could be prone to cyber attacks, to software bugs, and control failures. So this is a dramatic shift that certainly will play out in the sector in the next 4 or 5 years to come. So just quickly to summarize a few of the things that I've been speaking about. The insurance industry in 2025 has to really sit back and envision the next wave. They have to think about 5 key things to my mind. One, as I said, technology is set to disrupt the sector, and insurance companies are going to become fully digitized. The ones that thrive in 2025 will be fully digitized companies. And we do believe that technology giants, we do believe that new entrants will play a key role in the sector. They may not replace legacy companies, but the manner in which they collaborate, partner with legacy companies is going to fundamentally change the sector. The second thing I strongly believe is that insurance companies will move to be providing more than just insurance. We've already seen that with the Discovery model, the Vitality offering, you know, with wearables and things like that. But we see more and more value-added services coming in. You know, the morning example about Ping An, they are a bank, they're an insurance company, they have, you know, real estate services and offerings. It's already happened, but you know, this is not going to be a one-off example. This is going to be more the norm. The third thing, which I alluded to earlier, was this whole fundamental change in the customer relationship and engagement paradigm. You know, 10 years back, it was good for an insurer to be settling claims efficiently. And if you did your claim settlement well, it was a job really well done. But from there, in the last 5 years, we saw insurance companies positioning themselves as a lifetime partner to their clients. And the game has moved again from there to not just partnering the client, not just giving them value-added services, not just settling claims, but actually working in ways to actually prevent the claims incidents from occurring in the first place. And then, you know, obviously digitally servicing the clients. The lines between life insurance, home insurance, auto insurance are also blurring. Not only are we going to see bundled products, which I think again was spoken about, but you know, it's not going to be distinct products. It's about managing the customer in a very different way and meeting, you know, all their insurance needs in a bundled fashion. And then, you know, this whole paradigm shift that we're talking about, operating models changing, and a completely new breed of insurance leadership. Now, when you look at markets where there are 30, 40, 50, 60 players, in many markets in the world, you could be a number 10, number 12 player and yet reasonably profitable. I think this fundamentally is going to change because you are going to see consolidation in the sector. We are seeing that globally. You're likely to see that even in some form or shape in the Indian market. And the gap between those who have successfully transformed and those who are left behind will widen incredibly. So just to conclude from a boardroom perspective, I think the key thing that people are concerned about is that, you know, in a way the sector is being asked to redefine its purpose. Fundamentally, clarify its true value proposition and differentiate the brand. You know, this is from a strategic point of view, this is what is keeping most CEOs awake, that, you know, in a way you have to redefine your purpose, clarify your value proposition, differentiate your brand. And obviously, looking at all the disruption, looking at all the change, looking at what technology can enable us to do, the execution around connected offerings, connected solutions, the execution around real-time risk assessment, you know, we talk about active claims. Having the capability in your organization to drive all of this, partnering in the ecosystem, and managing this sort of tech-enabled transformation is the key challenge. So 2025 may seem very far away. It is not. The scale of change, the scale of disruption is fairly unprecedented. And we truly believe that this is really the paradigm that companies have to gear up for in the next 5 to 7 years. Then those who do that successfully will significantly increase the gap between themselves and other players in the market. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Those were some great insights on the fact that our industry is going to undergo a lot of changes in the near future. Our next topic is product and service innovation, disruptors of future insurance markets. Mr. Bhargav Das Gupta will be discussing on the same, before which I would like to give a brief introduction of Mr. Das Gupta. Sir is the Managing Director and CEO at ICICI Lombard General Insurance Company Limited. Mr. Das Gupta began his career with the erstwhile ICICI Limited in 1992, and sir has held key leadership positions in the diverse business areas in the ICICI Group, including project finance and corporate banking, e-commerce and technology management, international banking, and life insurance. Sir, I kindly request you to carry forward the proceedings.
Well, thank you, NIA and Mr. Srinivasan, for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to be here in this conference. This conference is a bit different because when we are talking about the future, this is a conference where we see the future leaders of this industry. So it's always good to see the students here. I was asking Mr. Srinivasan, you know, what's the constituency of the group here? I was expecting maybe about 75% students. But it's also a good, you know, mix in terms of industry, you know, veterans as also students. So, you know, it's always challenging to talk about any of these themes coming after the first speaker. So Sandeep really has done a broad brush coverage of all the key aspects that I guess each one of us wanted to talk about. But he covered a large aspect of the industry, you know, from the strategic perspective, the boardroom perspective, the 30,000 feet view of the industry. I've been asked to talk about the service and product innovation. And when I was thinking of the presentation, I decided against a presentation because I felt that this is a topic that I guess we've talked a lot about. And, you know, my sense is that most of you would know probably everything that I wanted to talk about. So rather than talking about the, you know, elements, a lot of which Sandeep has already covered, you know, I just wanted you to humor me. And I wanted to ask you a question. And any one of you who are aware of this insurance company that I am going to name out, just please raise your hands. And I'm hopeful that the backbenchers will be more participative. So the first one is Lemonade. How many of you have heard of Lemonade? That's roughly about 30-35% of the group here. And mostly the students seem to know about Lemonade. The second name, Zhongan. How many of you know about Zhongan? Bit less. I'm a bit surprised. Some people know about Zhongan. How many people know of Droplet? Much less. So I see only one hand. So let me take 2 minutes to explain what Droplet does. Droplet is a Singapore-based insurance company which pays for any surge price that happens on ride-sharing platforms like the Olas or the Ubers here, but, you know, Grab there. And it pays for the difference in terms of surge price if there's rain. Because whenever there's rain, the number of taxis that are available comes down. And because of surge price, the price goes up 50-60%, though they pay 60% of the cost of the ride. That's what Droplet does. That's their, as of now, the only business model. How many of you heard of Metromile? Yes, a bit more. Again, you know, very granular, UBI-based in, you know, insurance. So, you know, last one name. How many of you have heard of Oscar? Fewer, but still some. You know, Oscar is seen as one of the most innovative, you know, new age insurance company, which is potentially radically transforming the way health insurance is conceptualized. Their thought process is that they will think of keeping their patients healthy by investing a lot in terms of advice, in terms of concierge service, in terms of keeping them, you know, giving them, you know, services to keep, rather than just focus on the sickness care. Now, if you've heard about these companies, you know, in a sense, my talk is over, because 5 years from now in India, I guess that's what we hope to see happen in this market. And if you see the key themes out of each of these, what they've been focusing on doing is driven by three, in my opinion, you know, big changes that are happening in the system. And, you know, Sandeep focused on some of them. And in fact, he focused on all of them. I'll just pick up three out of those items. One is what we all know, the technology shifts. And within technology, I would argue that it's to do with connected devices. And it is to do with very high level of computing power, which is available on the tap. And it's cheap. So that's one big change that is happening, which is technology. The second big change is explosion of data and development of data sciences, again driven by the technology and the first change that I talked about. And third, consequent to the first two of them, is changing the consumer behaviors. Consumer expectations are changing. They want immediate service. They want, you know, personalized products. They want, you know, low ticket products. And effectively, they're benchmarking insurance with everything else that they're experiencing on the digital world. And if you think about these companies, they've actually taken advantage of these large disruptive, you know, forces that are playing out in the across the economies, and they've actually either come up with completely new solutions which you could never think of delivering. If you think about, let's say, what Lemonade does, or what Droplet does, you couldn't have imagined selling a $1 insurance policy if it were not completely digital. So they've come out with solutions which, in the past, these were maybe real risks or, you know, new risks that are emerging because of changes to consumer behavior in terms of driving behavior, shared economy changes. But they're coming up with new solutions to new risks, which earlier wasn't possible. So it's, in a sense, expanding the market of insurance. Alternatively, they're changing the consumer experience. I mean, if you look at, let's say, what Lemonade does. Lemonade starts by saying that the insurance model is broken. Insurance model is broken because insurers start with distrusting customers. And all of us in insurance, I think you'll agree with me, saying that our first worry is that what happens if the claim is a fraudulent claim. And that is a broken relationship with a customer, because you cannot start your premise of a customer relationship assuming that your customer is dishonest. But we, having seen frauds and we having seen the problems that are there, I mean, when I first came in from banking into insurance, my first thought process was exactly that. How can we start a relationship with a, you know, vicious cycle of distrust? You have to start with a virtuous cycle of trust, which in the past environment, you could never do, because technology wasn't available to figure out on a real-time basis using AI, machine learning, and, you know, some of these solutions that are possible today to figure out who's a genuine customer, who isn't. That's something that, you know, these guys have built, and that's something Lemonade has done. So they're changing the business paradigm using these changes in technology and consumer behavior that I talked about. Or they're disrupting the distribution model by saying that I don't want to pay, you know, I'll go direct to customers, I will pass on the benefit to my customers. So these are, to me, the large changes that are happening. And if you want to talk about or want to learn a bit more about the product and service solutions that you'll see 5 years from now, these are solutions that if you study, you'll learn more than what I can talk about here. So I want to talk a bit differently. I want to talk about something else, not just about what insurance companies can do and, these aspects that I just talked about. I want to pick up on another theme that is very, close to our heart. And that theme is, how do you add value as an industry to the customers? In the mind of the customer, what is the value proposition that we are providing as an industry? And again, this is also something that Sandeep covered in his slides, and I'm going to, pick up on that theme, which is a theme of, in the mind of the consumer, what he's worried about is a risk and he wants it to be mitigated. Whether we do it as an insurance industry or someone else does it, he's not bothered. He is not worried about sickness, he is worried about healthcare. He is worried about risk mitigation, not risk transfer. And as an industry, we have not expanded our horizon to think on those terms. We think of ourselves as a risk transfer partner, which means that give me the premium, if a claim happens, I'll pay you the claim. That, in our opinion, is a very limiting scope, and that is unnecessarily limiting the opportunity that we see as an industry to serve true customer needs. So if you look at on the commercial side, and I'll give a couple of examples on the commercial side. If you look at on the commercial side, you can take a fire insurance. If there is a flood, I will pay whatever is the material damage claims, and I'll settle the amount, and it's over. That's a pretty limiting of scope, as I explained. If you look at marine transit, if some of the goods get damaged, I'll pay for the claim. That's how we think of insurance. But think from the business owner's perspective. The business owner is only wanting his goods to reach there on time. He's not bothered about claiming. A genuine business owner is not bothered about claiming. He wants his goods to be transported in time. He wants his factories to be running all the time. Now, while we are talking about technology as a disruptive forces, technology is today giving us an opportunity as an industry to actually solve exactly that need of a customer. That need is to say that, can I use technology, can I use sensors, can I use IoT, can I use telematics to prevent the damage to happen in the first place? So if you look at, let's say, marine transit, and these are solutions that are in the market, some of us are already, at least for 5 years we've been giving the solution in the market. If you look at marine transit, hijacking risk, you can mitigate through, telematic devices. We're already doing that. If you look at refrigerated cargoes, you can have a small sensor where if the, particularly foods, frozen foods or pharmaceuticals, if you think that the cargo, the temperature is going below, the sensor will give you a trigger, you call up the driver and figure out why the refrigerated van is not refrigerated. That is the solution that is true customer value creative solution. And our experience is when you create value for your customer is the only time that you as an industry can create value. So that's one opportunity on the commercial side. Similarly, if you look at healthcare, and my apologies, Krishnan, you probably want to talk about this more, but I just want to give a couple of examples on healthcare side. I talked about the big changes in terms of computing power and data and connected devices. These are the big changes that we are seeing. If you look at the disruption that is happening to the healthcare industry, the changes are not being brought about by the current providers or the healthcare industry. It's being done by others. It is being done by healthcare startups in the valley who are using data to change the way healthcare is provided to individuals. And if you study some of the work that is happening, if you're interested, the best place to learn about this on the healthcare changes is Singularity University. They do a lot of work in this. I mean, if you go online, you'll find a lot of stuff, a lot of videos on this. And I would urge you to, if you're interested in healthcare changes, it's something that you should spend time on. But just to give you a couple of examples, Kaiser Permanente is one of the hospitals. They are not a drug discovery company. They use data and analytics to reduce brain stroke losses by 40% using the existing same drugs, new existing statins. They didn't change the drugs. This is something traditionally, something the pharma industry would have done. A hospital is doing that. If you look at, the wearables, everyone talks about wearables, the Apple Watch, which, today has ECG also. There is a company which now measures the potassium level without any intervention, on the watch. So these are solutions that are coming in the market. Question is, as an industry, do we just watch from the sidelines and see this change happen? or do we play a role in shaping this this change? Because as I said, for the customer, he wants to say, he or she wants to stay healthy. He or she logically doesn't want to go to a hospital. And if you see the changes that are being predicted on the healthcare side, the prediction is over the next 15 years, and the 15 years could be 20, 25 years, but over the next 15 years, because of these technology changes, the cost of healthcare will drop 5x, the error rates will drop 5x, and cost will go down 5x. And individually, because of devices, sensors, wearables, et cetera, whatever we call these things, as also the AI-driven physicians, you as an individual will be more in control of your healthcare or of your health than a physician. So you don't really need to go to hospitals. And some people are predicting that 90% of the hospitals from 15 to 20 years from now will become bankrupt because there won't be enough patients. Now, this is something that as an industry, as an insurance industry, we can do a lot more about, because this is core to our capability in terms of data and analytics and finding these solutions. So the question that we need to ask ourselves is, do we want to keep ourselves limited to paying claims, or do we want to solve the true risk needs of our customers? And today, whether we go there or not depends on many things, but today that opportunity is arriving because of the technology changes. The last thing that I want to talk about is dinosaurs, and I'm sure you understand why I'm talking about dinosaurs. Dinosaurs ruled the world for 165 million years. Humans have been there for less than 2 million years. They were strong, big, very powerful, but they died out 65 million years back. And the same thing is true for corporates and for industries. As an industry, if you are not adaptive, if you are not nimble, if you don't change, we may be very strong and powerful at a point in time, as an industry or as a companies. If you don't make those changes, we will be like dinosaurs. And this message is not just for us as corporates, it's a message to the regulator. I think the regulator has done some good, first steps in terms of the sandbox, but that's just the first step. The ideas that we talked about in terms of these companies that I talked about in the beginning, those solutions today are not even possible in India, given the current regulatory regime. So there is a lot of work that we need to do as companies, as also with the regulator, to allow us to make these changes possible. If that happens 5 years from now, I'm sure as an industry we'll see a lot of change that we keep talking about, but till now haven't delivered. And lastly, I'll just make a point that at the end of the day, everyone talks about the disruption coming from outside. Everyone says that retail was changed by Amazon, not by Walmart. Automobiles changed by Tesla, not by GM. Space travel is changed by SpaceX and not by Lockheed Martin. But that's not necessarily true for insurance. And you heard the example of Ping An. I mean, if you see what Ping An is doing, even in healthcare with its good doctor model, or what Discovery has done in the healthcare space, it's remarkable what an insurance company can achieve. Thinking about the customer and solving the customer's true needs, rather than limiting themselves to stay within the insurance narrow boundaries of insurance as we have defined the boundary for ourselves. That's an opportunity. Whether we'll get there in 5 years from now, I do not know, but I do hope we get there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for driving our attention towards the changing business paradigm and consumer behavior due to the new disruptive forces. Next, we have with us Mr. Krishnan Ramachandran, who will be presenting on the topic, Innovation in Health Insurance, Emerging Risks Shaping the Health Insurance Market. Mr. Ramachandran is Chief Executive Officer at Apollo Munich Health Insurance Company Limited. Sir is amongst the founding members of Apollo Munich. Over the last 12 years, Sir has handled important leadership roles, including COO and Deputy CEO. Mr. Ramachandran has close to 2 decades of global experience, including a 6+ years of tenure with Deloitte New York, where Sir provided advisory services to several US insurance companies. Sir, I kindly request you to take over.
So let me start with a confession that I feel like a little bit like a nervous ant between two very agile elephants in ICICI and Tata. So do forgive me if I ramble a little bit. You know, as Bhargav rightly pointed out, we have some very bright and young minds from NIA today. And I do want to, rather than being prescriptive, I thought I'd take this opportunity to pose some problem statements which I believe are fundamentally very important for the structural evolution of our industry. And maybe some of these could turn into research topics, Mr. Srinivasan or Mr. Sampath, because I do believe that as far as healthcare and health insurance is concerned, we have some very, very big problems to solve as a country and as an industry. Let me jump right into my presentation, but I have sort of framed these problem statements into two buckets. One is what I believe, and these are not necessarily in any particular order of importance, but just a few topics that I felt are worthwhile debating about and possibly looking at solutions. So one is from a macro perspective, what's going on in healthcare and what is the impact on health insurance? And from an industry standpoint, what do I think are some of the important dynamics that we need to solve for? You know, whenever we talk about India, India's healthcare or health status of Indians, invariably, we talk about the twin burden that our country carries. One is non-communicable disease and the other is infectious disease. So I had our team actually look at, our data over the last several years across both the retail and corporate. And what you see in the slide, we say that India needs to prepare for the rising burden of non-communicable disease. And what our data, and I'd like to think that this is a reasonable proxy of where the industry is, and this is a fairly mature book that we have over the last 12 plus years, says that, and it's quite stark, over 60% of our claims by value are being driven by non-communicable disease. So, two points I want to make. Firstly, this is not just anecdotal, not something that, that is spoken about, but it is also real and true. And our data at least seems to bear this out. That's point number one. Point number two, and more fundamentally in terms of what it means for us as an industry, for us as a healthcare ecosystem, and indeed India as a country, is that we are very inadequately prepared to handle this, let me say, something that's almost a crisis. For most part, whether it's healthcare delivery or health insurance, the bulk of our focus, it's not everyone, it's not every player, but the bulk of what we do is focused around acute care events. It is about handling a particular event, as Bhargav stated, and Sandeep before them. For most part, whether it's healthcare or insurance, we define our job in terms of handling an event. So somebody has a heart attack, gets hospitalized, treated for the hospitalization. The healthcare industry doesn't really do a great job of customer relationship management. And the health insurance industry, for most part, confines itself to handling and settling the claim. And a lot of our focus goes around making that experience. And indeed, I would argue, we've done a reasonable job of making that experience through technology as a reasonably good experience. But the reality is that non-communicable diseases require an episode of care approach. They need a healthcare 360 approach, something to akin, for example, what a Kaiser Permanente does, as Bhargav rightly pointed out. But the reality is that whether it's healthcare delivery or health insurance, as an industry, we are woefully, inadequately prepared to handle the NCD burden. And really, if you in terms of thinking about how you solve this, we have to think through platform and ecosystem approaches in terms of how we handle this as a country and as an industry. The second, we are talking about lots of advancement in a lot of fields. But the unfortunate reality is that even today in India, routinely, people die on account of infectious disease, whether it's dengue, malaria, or typhoid. And there are two aspects that I want to highlight you know, as far as infectious disease is concerned. One is what you see on the chart, and you know, the denominator actually represents quarters. So this is, you know, our data de-identified for the last 24 quarters, if I read the chart right. And this tells you that there is quite a bit of seasonality to infectious disease. And all of you know this, it's common sense, that post-monsoon for a 3-4 month period, you know, there is a sharp surge in infectious disease. And for example, in our case, as high as 50% of our claims by volume are on account of infectious disease, depending on the quarter. In terms of the problem statement, really this is a problem of public health. This is a problem of lack of sanitation. This is a problem of poor public hygiene. And this is a problem, of poor awareness. And just to give you an example to illustrate, you know, why I say, it is obvious that it is a problem of public health. But let me take this example of awareness and what a difference it has made. So this year, you know, every year around this time, Delhi is, sees an epidemic of dengue. And this year, the Chief Minister, Arvind Kejriwal, in my opinion, has done an outstanding job of creating public awareness around a few simple things that, you know, population at large could do to prevent dengue fever. And the fact of the matter is, we're sitting in October, past Dashara and getting towards Diwali, and NCR, there has not been any one reported case of dengue-related death this year. So really, you know, the point which I want to make is that, this is a problem as far as the industry is concerned, because, any company wants predictability in results, and obviously this kind of fluctuation, mitigates against predictability. But this is a problem that we cannot by ourselves alone solve. You know, 44 insurance companies writing health insurance with varying degrees of focus, solving the public health problem of India is not something that we can solve. So this calls for, let me say, a partnership or an ecosystem approach where we need to necessarily partner with government, governmental agencies, in order to solve this problem for ourselves as well as the country. And it's not just seasonality, but also cyclicality. And really the chart on the page here illustrates that, look, it's not just seasonal, you know, post-monsoon, but also the severity of what we see on infectious disease has a cyclical pattern to it. And here, in addition to partnership solutions, the other point I want to make is, look, I think there's not enough that's being done, for example, in developing vaccines for, let me say, third world / developing countries, and in the spirit of going beyond our remit of just paying claims, I think there's partnerships that we can forge with, for example, pharma companies, investments that we can make, in drugs which are, let me say, not as profitable from a pharmaceutical industry standpoint, but which would make eminent sense for us, to make our results and our financials much more stable as far as this portfolio is concerned. Now, it is true that India is a young nation, but it is also equally true that we have more senior citizens in India than the population of Germany. You know, the census data, is a little dated, but it goes back to, the real data. If you look at it, it's over 100 million people who are more than 60 years old, and it's predicted that that number will go up to in excess of 130 million people by 2025. Now, again, as populations age, it is common knowledge that non-communicable disease incidence goes up. But also equally importantly, in addition to the NCD issue, this population, will suffer from health issues like dementia, like Alzheimer's, there will be disability. And in terms of what the healthcare and health financing system need to do to deal with geriatric care, whether it's assisted living facilities, whether it's skilled nursing or long-term care, again, this is not something that we talk about. You know, all of the public discourse is about India's demographic dividend. But the reality also, and for any of you who have, aged parents, this is a reality that especially as longevity goes up and Indians start to live 70, 75, 80 years, I think these issues are going to come more and more to the surface, and again a problem statement for the country and for the industry in terms of how we deal with this. And the last one in this nature that I want to touch upon is actually something that's not much spoken about, although because of certain high court and regulatory interventions, this is a somewhat hot topic as far as health insurance is concerned. And I read this fairly interesting book some time ago called Dying for Your Paycheck. It's by a MIT professor, and really there's a lot of evidence that states that stress, mental health, whether it's depression, there's a very, very high correlation to health status. And this is, the statistics here are quite alarming, but even with what you see, the extent of underdiagnosis as far as mental health is concerned in India is quite stark. So again, as health insurers, I think we need, and because this has implications on health status, so whether it's stress, you can draw correlations to cardiovascular disease, you can draw correlation to diabetes. So again, this is something that I'd say is a looming problem as far as India is concerned, especially with, I think one of the earlier speakers referred to increasing urbanization and the stress of modern day jobs. Again, this is something that requires concerted action from an ecosystem standpoint for us to solve. When we talk about, so that's really from a population health standpoint where I really think a lot of interesting thought and work and solutions can go into in terms of forming platform or ecosystem solutions. The other three topics that I wanted to speak about are really to do with, the microeconomics of the industry. And the first one is, really in a lot of the public media coverage, and indeed I'd say even from a regulatory standpoint, a lot of questions get asked, if your loss ratio is 60%, and this is probably more acute if you're a standalone company, 55 or 60%, what is the need for you to, ask for a premium revision? And really what I want to illustrate through this chart is that the premium revision cycle is a forward-looking activity, and we as insurance companies probably need to take at least a three-year view. We need to think ahead 3 years when we look at premium revision cycles. So